Also, we were just talking about jiu-jitsu getting bigger as a sport. Fortunately, now we're seeing it's taking its new heights, man. And who's to say in 5-10 years where jiu-jitsu is going to be? It's going to, like, especially now with Dana White involved, the UFC, you know, just as a sport, it's gone so much bigger. Even in England now, like, this gym's popping up everywhere. So, yeah.
Yeah, man. I think we're about to see the, like, the growth spurt that's about to happen is, it's gonna be interesting. But I'm stoked to be here. I know that if jiu-jitsu continues to grow, that it will. Athletes definitely. We need to have a more, when I seen athletes that are successful,
yeah,
they're not just great athletes, they're great in other fields.
Yeah.
So I feel like that's something that's going to help athletes in jiu-jitsu a lot as well to catch on to that.
Yeah.
Now before it's really like it's known more than it already is.
Yeah.
But it's I think that's a trait that for me it helped my game in jiu-jitsu, and I caught on to it later on, and I'm 23, so yeah. I still caught on to it somewhat young, some people could say, but I wish I knew about, you know, that's kind of like what parents guide you want to have a career.
Yeah.
And a lot of people want to have something that's like, oh, I want to do music, I want to be an athlete, I want to be an act, right? But you can learn so much along with that.
Yeah, yeah.
That's going to help you be better at that thing that you want to do, share with the world.
Yeah. So. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Natural Effect Podcast. I'm Natch, and today we have a special guest. We have the IBJJF World Champion, Roberto Jimenez. Welcome, my brother. How are you doing?
I'm good. Thank you. Good to be here.
Yeah, man. Thank you for coming along, man. Appreciate you coming. And it's for me, this is a big interview because he's on the alkaline lifestyle. For you guys who know at home, I love jiu-jitsu as well. If you guys who do love jiu-jitsu, you guys saw him fight on the co-main event just like a couple weeks ago on UFC Fight Pass. Tough fight against Nicky Rod.
Yeah, man, it was a good fight. We didn't come out with a win this time, but a lot of good takeaways from it. I feel like a lot of people put me on the list of no leg locks.
Yeah, yeah.
And I kind of showed with this fight that, you know, I might not have gotten the win, but... I don't think anyone else has put Nicky in a position like that in a fight.
Yeah, yeah.
Since ADCC 2022.
Yeah, yeah.
So, you know, all respect to Nick on his win, but, you know we're going to fight again, so we move forward.
Next time, that's it. And yeah, man, one of the other reasons I love watching you, bro, 84% ratio, finish rate, incredible. You always go for the submission. And like you were saying before, Offset, you were saying to me, it's important, though, to always be position over submission, right? Not to rush too much into trying to get that finish.
Yeah, so... Not to rush. Like, position over submission because... you see, for example, in this fight... I was too focused on the submission. So I gave up a lot of positions. And it's just learning experience, really. I felt like I was so focused on wanting to get that leg lock because it's something I've been working on.
Yeah.
That I wanted it too much and it slipped.
Yeah, yeah. So. Do you think it was also because it's more personal for you because you're not known for leg locks? You're known, when you have lost, you're known like from leg locks. So was it, you wanted to prove that point? Like, you know what? Fuck you guys, you'll see.
You know, it's our love to everyone, yeah, yeah. Even if you're sending, you know, not the
no,
not
I'm more, the I'm more competitive love, you know, like you wanted to show people, like, you know, people been saying leg locks are my weakness, let me show you guys. Yeah,
yeah, yeah, yeah. You know, that's really the one, but
yeah.
It's also just the fact that I used to do leg locks. I used to do hit, like the first time I fought a black belt when I was like 14, 15, I won the fight. And I was mainly attacking legs.
Yeah.
You know, so it was kind of like, this has always been around. It's just, I didn't do it for a long time because I'm not only doing no gi, I was doing gi.
Yeah, yeah.
But to be honest, how the sport is growing, I wouldn't be surprised to when we get to the point where we have athletes. Like, that's what I see as, like, the vision for me, you know, is... Yeah. I want to be fighting at the highest level in gi and no gi, and I have no limit, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Open to whatever. To both. Comes.
Yeah, yeah. Because a lot of the jiu-jitsu guys, they either only do gi or they only. I know there's some that do both, but majority of the time, there's like guys kind of stick to one, right?
Kinda. Like everybody has different origins in the in the art, so. For me, I always grew up, jiu-jitsu complements MMA. And that's kind of the environment that I grew up in.
Correct. Yeah.
And then later on, I learned, oh, like there's only jiu-jitsu. There's competitive jiu-jitsu. It's not just you have to learn how to do it for MMA.
Yeah.
So it's come to a point now where it's kind of like meeting together, like competitive jiu-jitsu with MMA jiu-jitsu.
Yeah.
And I think the best for the sport is yet to come, is just yet to arrive. But there was this like nostalgic era, right, of jiu-jitsu where it was like, I remember watching Buchecha, Marcus Almeida, Leandro Lo, Rodolfo Vieira, Bruno Malfacini, Lucas Lepre, Marcelo Garcia, just to name a few, right?
Terere. You train under Lucas Lepre, isn't it?
I trained with Lucas for like a handful of years.
Yeah, yeah.
A handful of years, and that's when we were all Alliance, right?
Yeah, yeah.
My family, my dad started jiu-jitsu, so we started with my dad in Ecuador.
Yeah.
And then once we got to U.S., like, we were kind of finding a team. You know, so eventually we found Alliance, but during pandemic and everything, we couldn't pay the monthly for the team. So we just kept training and we're like, all right, we'll just start our own team.
Yeah, nice. And your dad originally, when he got into martial arts, it was Muay Thai first and then, right? It was Muay Thai first and then he got into jiu-jitsu, right?
Yeah.
Have you ever got into Muay Thai or not really?
Yeah.
Nice.
I was in love with Muay Thai before jiu-jitsu.
Okay. Yeah man, and it's crazy, like, it's incredible to be under your father as well, who's also like a black belt jiu-jitsu, Raul Gaucho Jimenez.
Yeah, not only black belt in jiu-jitsu, but just overall, just legend, you know?
Legend,
He was known for like the, just, he'd get in a fight if there had to be a fight in Ecuador before jiu-jitsu. So that's kind of what brought him into jiu-jitsu, was like, oh, you always the guy, so come train.
Yeah. And how is it in from what I gathered, even hearing Chito Vera talk, fighting's quite a big thing in Ecuador, right? People love to fight, right?
Yeah.
On the streets.
You might as well just, you know, if you have a problem, let's put it up.
Yeah.
And that's it. It's I feel like that's how it should be.
It should be. I agree with you, man. Rather than all the like the guns and knives, I reckon if we just used our hands, whoever loses, it is what it is. A lot of times I find in fights, you tend to gain respect for each other after a fight anyway.
No matter what.
Yeah. It's true. And how's life in general in Ecuador?
Man, Ecuador's beautiful. I'm always at the beach out there, you know. To me, it's when you're in Ecuador, it's surf, train jiu-jitsu, and I mean, I eat a lot of fruit and fish out there, so.
Yeah, and I'm guessing the product out there is like food product is much better than here, right? More wild and organic.
If you're at the beach and you're staying like on one of the towns, like little towns, so it's more like surf towns or whatever, it's like that. That's the vibe where you can have a fruit market right there, everything that you need. But you find a little bit of because you find anything you can looking for, you can find in Ecuador. But if you're looking for fresh fruit, you know, somewhere to get away like that, Ecuador is one of those spots.
Yeah. I knew it would have good produce, man. And like the jungles over there, amazing.
The Amazon.
Yeah. Definitely need to visit for sure. And you were still even saying even the herbs over there, they have
I have a lot of knowledge out there about herbs and you know, it's one of the few places that has, I think, the largest biodiversity for how small of a country it's considered to be.
Yeah.
So you have the Amazon, you have the Andes, the Galapagos Islands, like desert that's close to the coast. So it's, you know, whether diverse. You like the cold or
Pretty like similar to California, right?
Because
they say in California you can go skiing and surfing in the same day. So I can't believe you started at 4 years old, right?
About four.
That's crazy. And even now he's only 23, guys. Only 23 is insane. Such a killing it from such a young age. How did you feel when you first got into jiu-jitsu? Because from my understanding, watching your documentary, which I think everyone should go check out, it was an epic one. It was a tough time for you at the beginning, right?
Yeah, I didn't really like it because I grew up not wanting to get hurt or hurt anyone.
Yeah,
that was just whatever, grandma's boy.
Yeah,
so. I always liked Dragon Ball Z, right? Yeah. I like that rest in peace.
Yeah, rest in peace, man. The founder, what's his name? The Japanese guy he just had recently. But rest in peace to the.
No, we have to give credit.
We have to give credit. Get his name up, yeah, for sure. The Dragon Ball Z.
But it was watching, like, one of my clearest memories as a kid is being like just sitting there watching Dragon Ball Z before anything.
Yeah.
And then that's one of the first things I thought of when I saw martial arts. So that even if I didn't like it as a kid,
yeah,
I always had that like, keep going, something good will come out of this, because you know, how can it be so tough and then there's no reward?
Reward, yeah.
You know.
That's it, Akira Toriyama. Yeah, rest in peace, man. And as we get older, now you're older, you realize that you have to go through the pain to get the gain, right? You can't get a positive without no negatives. Even training, you have to work hard in order to get the gold.
It's you know, growing pains.
Yeah.
That's what it is.
Yeah, it's true. And okay, so Dragon Ball Z definitely influenced you as well growing up, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, because I started, I think my first tournament was at 7 or 6, 7 years old. And then I didn't ever know, I didn't get my first place medal as a anything until 14 or 13.
Yeah, it took a while.
Yeah. And then after, before I even, like the first time I won a tournament in jiu-jitsu, I remember thinking, I wasn't even thinking about winning or losing. I just want to do better.
Then
the result showed. And I feel like that's how life is, really. If we focus on like, this is how it has to be, this is like, just do better. And then the vision becomes clear.
Yeah, and you talk a lot about enjoying the moment, flowing, just going with it, not focusing on just the win, right?
We're here now, so let's enjoy this life. Even if we got to get things done, you know.
Yeah.
Just love life.
And talking of being a kid as well, when I watched your documentary, I don't know if it was one of the influences in your life, but from what I understand, you was picked on as a kid by a school bully, right? And then eventually, from my understanding, did you armbar him or something?
Nah, so dudes was talking about my mom one time, and then I kept saying like, yo, just don't take it there.
Yeah.
And then he kept on poking at it, so I was like, all right. I threw him, and then I tried to do like a Americana with my leg on his arm.
Yeah.
And it was just, I didn't want to hurt him. He just poked too much, and it was whatever.
It was a time the bully got humbled, right?
Yeah. I didn't get it because I would be to myself. You know, I was the kid at school. I would just sleep.
Yeah.
I just sleep thinking about technique.
Yeah.
Like, you seen that show, what's that Netflix one with the girl who does checkers? Not checkers, chess.
Girl who does chess. I don't know if I've watched it.
She's like an orphan, and then she like she look at the ceiling, and then she like thinks of the moves that she's gonna play, and she becomes like the whatever.
Is it Lucy or something?
No, it's the Queen's Gambit, I think.
Okay. I don't think I've watched it. Okay.
Well, that's how I felt in school. I swear, I was just
calm.
I would go to sleep and just think of technique.
Yeah.
Like I could care less what
about education
being said. Yeah, yeah, but you know what was important, like 1 + 1, I caught on to. You know,
maths. Was because me growing up, like how your father is with MMA, my father was like that with soccer. And honestly, from my father's standpoint, he didn't really give a fuck about my education, really. Like, as long as I was a good kid, he didn't care. Was it the same for you guys where jiu-jitsu overtook education? Like,
so my dad comes from like a very mixed background, right? So I feel like he wanted me to do jiu-jitsu, but also have a career.
Yeah.
And then I got to the once I was like 13, around that age, I was like, nah, I already know what I want to do.
Yeah,
I'm doing this. I don't know what I can make out of it, but I know I can make something out of this, and I see greatness with this.
Like, yeah,
I've been doing it for long enough that I know I can catch on to it now. You know, even if I didn't like it the first 12 years of my life.
Yeah.
So he was always like, nah, go to school. So I would have to sneak out of school and then go around my dad to go to practice.
Back to the mats.
But for my family, it was really like jiu-jitsu was like a light that helped pull us out of a dark place. You know, so yeah. I can be like what I am now because I learned a lot from the art and not just listening to people, just learning from my own life experience and then realizing that we're all learning through this.
Yeah.
So I feel I have to share that. Jiu-jitsu, there's a light in there that can guide people through life.
I agree, man. And it can teach you things nothing to do with jiu-jitsu, right? Jiu-jitsu can teach you things in life, just in general, very humbling as well. And even as a self-defense, man, there's probably nothing better to learn, right?
Striking. If you can get them to, you know, if you can, we mix both of those. Everybody likes MMA, but it really is like that. If you're thinking about self-defense, I recommend do striking and jiu-jitsu.
Yeah, I prefer striking, but I still think that learning jiu-jitsu is probably safer for the streets and in general. A lot of people say, what are you going to do, pull guard? But there's a lot of submissions you can do while standing. You're not going to pull guard, obviously, on the street, right?
No, and if you find yourself on bottom, you know, if you find yourself on the ground for some whatever reason, you know how to, you don't feel uncomfortable.
Comfortable, yeah.
You know how to move.
Get him in a leg lock from the bottom. He won't know what's going on, especially if he's never done jiu-jitsu before. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Also, we were just talking about jiu-jitsu getting bigger as a sport. Fortunately, now we're seeing it's taking its new heights, man. And who's to say in 5-10 years where jiu-jitsu is going to be? It's going to, like, especially now with Dana White involved, the UFC, you know, it, just as a sport, it's gone so much bigger. Even in England now, like, this gym's popping up everywhere. So, yeah.
Yeah, man. I think we're about to see the... like the growth spurt that's about to happen is, it's gonna be interesting. But I'm stoked to be here. I know that if jiu-jitsu continues to grow, that it will. Athletes definitely, we need to have a more like when I seen athletes that are successful,
yeah.
they're not just great athletes, they're great in other fields.
Yeah.
So I feel like that's something that's going to help athletes in jiu-jitsu a lot as well to catch on to that.
Yeah.
Now before it's really like it's known more than it already is.
Yeah.
But it's I think that's a trait that, for me, it helped my game in jiu-jitsu. And I caught on to it later on. And I'm 23, so yeah. I still caught on to it somewhat young, some people could say. But I wish I knew about, you know, that's kind of like what parents guide you. You want to have a career.
Yeah.
And a lot of people want to have something that's like, oh, I want to do music. I want to be an athlete. I want to be an actor. Right? But you can learn so much along with that.
Yeah, yeah.
That's going to help you be better at that thing that you want to do, share with the world.
Yeah. And you hit the nail with a hammer, because the most successful, even UFC fighters, are guys who are able to be successful outside the octagon as well, whether like marketing themselves. Like, look at Israel Adesanya, look at even Conor, for example. Like, we were talking about this offset as well. Like, if you have no personality, unfortunately, doesn't matter how much of a good fighter you are. Even if you are the best fighter and you have no personality, you'll make it, but not as big. You need to be able to have things outside the mats or the octagon or the ring, right?
I mean,
like, you yourself, you're very unique. Like, you know, you're not your alkaline lifestyle. You know, I think your whole style of fighting is very unique in jiu-jitsu. But I think that's what's going to make jiu-jitsu bigger, because now when people watch you fight, or they watch someone like Gordon Ryan fight, you guys are very, like, unique fighters in your own way. Do you get what I'm saying? So people remember that, the way you guys look. Do you get what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Like, even having your own shorts, even little things, even down to that.
Yeah, I think it's an art of expression. So, you know, you have to, it's not only the moment of the fight. You got to express yourself, and you don't want to have a boring routine, right? Mm. So if you have to do this routine to be able to perform at a highest level, you don't want to have a boring routine. You want to have a routine that you can be, you have to keep that discipline, but also having fun through that. And I feel like that's where, like, the persona thing comes in.
Yeah.
Where, like, you have to have a character and this and that. But at the end of the day, it's like, I'm trying to keep it real as much as I can. We're also, like, we're about to go in there. We're about to fight.
Yeah, yeah.
But, you know, it's nothing personal. As long as we keep it respectful, I'm how I am. And, you know, I feel like we want to keep jiu-jitsu. Like, we, when I say we, is like the people I grew up with seeing in jiu-jitsu at the Worlds, at IBJJF, or at you know, an open mat, whereas a bunch of gyms from the local area. I remember jiu-jitsu keeping it pure back then was like not being too cocky or over talking.
Yeah.
But now it's kind of like we need to learn how to communicate, yeah, express ourselves, not only with the physical, with the art, with jiu-jitsu, but also with the words. And that's part of what jiu-jitsu is, really, is learning how to be one with the sword as we are with the pen.
Yeah.
So with the whole the opportunity of being able to have like a press conference or something in between the fights or before and after, it's something new for a lot of people that, yeah, are just really good at the sport.
Yeah.
So it's finding that balance, but I feel like it's gotta just be yourself, you, yeah, know? Like I want to share what's helping me, and also just show that it's not, you know, if I think if I can jump in and do jiu-jitsu where I'm coming from, anyone can do it. And then that's what I want to share with everyone.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
If I can think of it like, fuck, I don't want to go have a 9-to-5, and that's why I really wanted to do jiu-jitsu.
Yeah.
So I don't want to have a 9-to-5. I want to see the world. I want to, you know, I kind of want to, I want to surf.
Yeah.
I can't surf. There's no beach near me. So I'm going to do jiu-jitsu.
Yeah.
That's how I thought of it.
Doing something you love while being able to have free time around it.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's something that I feel like most people can relate to. If you don't have much around where you are.
Yeah.
You go to jiu-jitsu and it's like, damn, this is dope.
Yeah. Yeah. I agree, man. And yeah, for sure. I think press conferences and things like that will definitely improve the sport more. And it's funny what you said, because yeah, jiu-jitsu is going to change slightly now, because jiu-jitsu is always known as like the sport where there's not much like trash talking. It's not really known for that, right? Especially when you compare it to somewhere like MMA, like where there's trash talking completely, and that's how they build up the sport. But I do think in jiu-jitsu going forward, we're going to see more trash talking, more, you know, personal, not personal beefs, but you know, like, you know how John Jones and DC was, like, in, you know, like for example, you and Nicky Rod, I kind of see you guys like that in the future when you fight him again. Say you beat him next time, which I believe you will, and then you'll have that that competitive thing going and going. But I think that also builds the sport up, because it makes anticipation for the people watching it.
Yeah. Most definitely. You know, with that being said, it's like, I can only speak for myself.
Yeah.
With the sport, and I don't really train with any other higher, I don't train with any high level athletes besides my friend Renato in Vegas.
Yeah.
You know, on a day to day basis, and really 80% of my training is with my brother. You know, so that's why I feel like when we're talking about natural athletes,
yeah,
I don't think anyone is really doing it how I am. And I would like to see, you know, I wouldn't mind seeing other athletes doing, learning from what I'm doing, yeah, but just not only as a performance, but also just on the, if 90% of the sport is taking it, it's what, steroids or anything that you can't even read the ingredients of, mm-hmm, then you not taking that stuff, there's nothing to lose.
Yeah.
You know, I take fights with people who are on whatever they're on, and there's a 30-pound difference, and whether I win or lose, I'm going in there to fight.
Yeah.
And I'm going in there to show that, you know, what if we were both?
Yeah. Well, honestly, exactly how you feel when I watch you fight, I smirk and I laugh after, because I have friends in jiu-jitsu. People know I train at Gracie Barra. Like he said, 90% of BJJ guys are on juice, man. It is what it is. It's just factual. Like, even my own people, they do it. And they just tell me they do it. They're honest about it. And I know, bro, you can tell by looking at your body, you don't take nothing. You're on the alkaline lifestyle. And that's when you do fight, that's what I smirk about. I'm like, imagine Imagine if you didn't take nothing. You would have got tapped out already. Do you get what I'm saying? Like, not you, I mean them. Like, if they didn't take nothing a lot of times, because let's be honest, steroids are going to make you stronger. It definitely improves. It doesn't improve your endurance though, right? It's just power.
Not endurance. I mean, I don't really even know what it does besides it makes them angry. And but I do know that since I started eating alkaline food, probably like, or learning even what alkaline food was, 2018, 2019.
Yeah.
And started trying to eat alkaline 2020, 2021.
Yeah.
I got sick in 2022. So then I go to the hospital, I go to the dermatologist. I caught like a skin infection and it got bad. And 2022 was ADCC. So in the middle of ADCC camp, I get so sick. I'm feverish. My eyes are bloodshot red. I got all these blisters all over my body from my hips up. And I'm thinking, all right, they're saying 3 weeks for results. I already tried the ointments and stuff. I don't feel anything.
Yeah.
I literally asked for help. Like, God, send me someone. And then I sent a message to Victor on one of his, he made a post about somebody getting a detox. So I'm like, man, I need help. I contact, yo. And then Victor gets in contact with me. We get in contact together with someone else who can get Victor out to Vegas. We meet in person and then I do this detox and my skin is clear. I'm the most clear-headed I've ever felt in my life. And I feel alive. Like, I don't feel like I'm dying. And now I have probably like 2-3 weeks left before ADCC. So I said, all right, I've been in bed rest for about a month. I'm feeling good. I'm going to go in there. I'm going to do what I can. And I fought at 77 kilos, right? That's like 170 pounds.
Yeah.
3-day weigh-ins. And right now I'm like 202, roughly 202.
Yeah.
So that for me, the past 2 years has just been kind of like a big turbulation, a lot of turbulation. And we're starting to, you know, the clouds are clearing up and I can see a bit clear. So, now I'm eating like wild game, buffalo, bison, deer, wild fish, quinoa, garbanzo, wild rice, a lot of kamut pasta, things that can like help me build mass.
Yeah.
But it's not staying there and it's not heavy. It's doing what it needs to do, you know?
Yeah.
And drinking the tea, like I swear I do my routine right and I feel I can fight anyone.
Yeah.
And doing that the right amount of time and energy put into that. And I'm just still now developing how to do that as an athlete. Because think about this is new to me, to my life, but now I have to, it's not only on my like personal, I feel good.
Yeah.
It's like I have to feel good as an athlete as well.
Yeah.
So I'm feeling that. And, you know, I don't even take protein supplements or anything like that.
It's all garbage, isn't it, bro?
I can't find an alkaline one.
Yeah.
You know?
Which you've got your own one coming out in the future, right?
We're formulating something. Okay. We want to get the ingredients right, do it right.
Right, yeah, yeah.
So we're not in a rush, but we've had to do it ourselves because there's nothing out there in the market. There.
Yeah.
You know? And that's something I hope everybody can, you know, because it sucks. I have to have every, it sucks, but at the same time, it's like we have to wake up early in the morning and get the workout in at 3 to 5 a.m., whatever.
Yeah.
You know, today I flew in 7 a.m. I got to work out in between 4 and 5. And then got ready, we got in, got the podcast going. So it's those growing pains that are going to make the difference at the end of the day.
Yeah. And for people who know me, I've been alkaline for like 3.5 years now. I've been plant-based for a decade now. And I even still tell people, like, I would rather eat the way you're eating now, for example, than eat, like, you know, majority of vegans who eat, like, soy, tempeh, all like that garbage, impossible. However, obviously me, I'm not going to eat animal protein. I don't think there's any need for, but you yourself, obviously, you are, like, you are an athlete, you're young, you're a jiu-jitsu black belt who's, like, literally competing so many times. I see the amount of times you compete is insane. So would you say you felt a big difference from being alkaline without the non-hybrid meats? Or do you feel much more powerful now you've had the deer, what is it, bison, elk, and fish?
So out in North America, I find bison and fish the most.
Okay, cool.
I do feel a difference. Like, I've tried doing... So 2022, I did 6 months... plant-based.
Yeah.
I would say, like, I would eat some things that aren't alkaline.
Yeah.
But it was my first time going plant-based.
Yeah.
So I was kind of stepping into the step alkaline.
Step, yeah.
And I felt like when I was consistently eating plant-based alkaline, I felt very light.
Yeah.
Very light. Like I could not get tired.
Yeah.
I could not get tired. And I could roll with anyone, but I could not let anyone get a hold of me, you know, in jiu-jitsu. Because I didn't have that strength.
Yeah.
The mass. But once I added, and I was also doing that with the intention of fighting at 77 kilos, 170 pounds.
Yeah.
But once I started, like, all right, I'm going to go up and weight. I want to feel better.
Yeah.
And I started adding the animals. And not only the animals, because, like, this past 2 weeks, right? After fighting, I really been going in on a lot of bison ribeye, and it tastes amazing. But I don't like how I feel if I only eat bison ribeye for like 3 days straight.
Okay.
You see what I'm saying?
So you mix it within your, like, the alkaline foods.
I have to.
Yeah. Even
if it's like great, the best quality bison, I don't want to eat that every day.
Yeah.
Because I don't like feeling heavy.
Heavy. Yeah.
You know, that's why the benefit of eating the bison is that I feel strong, I feel dense, I feel like,
like
the energy of the bison.
Yeah.
But if you're swimming, you wouldn't have enough energy to swim across wherever you need to go to, but you also don't want to get tired.
Yeah.
So jiu-jitsu is like water. It really is the element of water. If striking is fire, jiu-jitsu is water.
Yeah.
And you have to be light enough. You have to take into consideration everything that you're bringing with you into the water.
Yeah.
Right? And that's where the nutrition comes in. We're eating because I can feel the difference in the energy when I'm training or when I'm fighting of when I ate. Back in the day, I would eat a lot of brown rice with turkey.
Yeah.
And I would feel like that, the lactic acid, right?
Yeah.
And the adrenaline comes in because it's running through the blood.
Yeah.
Like, ugh. And you have to push through that.
Yeah.
And there's a mental strength that happens from that.
Yeah.
But there's another, that same mental strength can be equivalent to, like, I'm not gonna eat that.
Yeah.
I need to eat this, and it tastes good. And then I don't have that feeling. So it's like, man, I'm really enjoying this in that sense.
Yeah.
Whether no matter the hurdles that come up, the process is fun and it's fulfilling. It's not, because there's some things that could be fun. I'm doing this, but this is fulfilling.
Yeah.
You know, when I get there, because it's not whether how, or it's really when I get there, whether that be ADCC world champion, IBJJF world champion, UFC world champion. When I get there, I know what I did.
Yeah.
And that to me is what the fulfilling part is.
Yeah, for sure, man. Because it's like a test to ourselves. Like, that's what I say to people as well. Like, don't do the same thing all the time. If you want to see changes, you took, you know, you got into the alkaline thing, but then you tried the wild meat. And like you said, the balance between the two is amazing. And just so the people understand as well, you wouldn't eat hybrid meats, right?
No, I don't need
no chicken, no beef, no turkey. Mm-mm. And if you go research all these animals, a lot of them have viruses, and a lot of them have been bred to be what they are, like, for example, beef. So yeah, man, it's definitely interesting take. Obviously I heard Joe Rogan talking about bison a lot, elk. Obviously me myself, I've never tried that, probably never will, but you never know. Hey. But, yeah, it's crazy, man. Definitely good to know for sure. And like I tell you guys as well, even when I try and coach you guys, and a lot of you guys at home, you guys turn around and say, but I don't want to stop eating meat. Even like, for example, spin, a lot of my friends around me, I tell them, you want to carry on eating meat, it's best to eat as wild meat as possible, just like Roberto does, but have your alkaline diet while you're doing it. Have your ancient grains, have all your non-hybrid and seeded fruits and vegetables, and even herbs are definitely important, right? Your sarsaparilla root, your burdock.
Can't forget that. Yeah, gordolobo.
Gordolobo for the lungs, especially as we smoke weed as well.
Yeah, and the sea moss.
Yeah,
Whether you're active or not, like, that makes a huge... For me, when I eat sea moss or put in a smoothie or whatever... However I get it in, it's a huge difference in the cramps.
Okay, yeah.
Right, you know, when you get that like 3-4 times a day training, and then water sometimes is not enough. Like, if I get water with fruit and sea moss, that for me...
Elite, yeah. Man. And it nourishes our bones as well. And honestly, sea moss is like our steroids, right? you need your sea moss before a tournament, right?
Most definitely. Yeah. It's wild, really, what it does.
It is, man. And for people who don't know about sea moss, watching this channel, you should already know 92 minerals out of 102 minerals needed for the body. Insane. So definitely, guys, go and get some sea moss. So you also talk about not getting too attached to medals as well, right?
Medals, nah. I mean, it's cool because it's something... Like, I grew up doing this, you know, so it's something I've seen since I was a young one.
Yeah.
It's like, I want to get that. Back then, it's like, I want to be a world champion, and whatever medal is that year is only going to be for that year. Now it's what kind of contribution can I... You know, what am I contributing to the sport in the long run? Like, even when I'm gone, was there any athletes that were able to do things different? That's what I'm here to do things different. So the medals don't matter. It's the fights and how I prepare for those fights and what I'm learning after.
Yeah, leaving a legacy as a person, not just for your medals, right? And I think that's important, because a lot of time, even if you look in the past, great champions that didn't do much for the world, they don't get remembered like the people that did. Like, I for example, I think like Kobe Bryant will be always remembered longer than LeBron will, even though LeBron's one of the best ever, one of the GOATs as well, in my opinion. But just because of what Kobe did... Like, outside basketball, like, I think he was more, you know, for the people.
And that goes into that, you know, he was... I remember watching interviews of Kobe where he's talking about, where like, what were you doing in the bus on the way to the game? You know, I'm learning about what I'm going to do after I'm done playing, you know? And that's... I was going to mention something about... Even Muhammad... Like, once I learned more about the story of Muhammad Ali, it's like, man changed his name. He wasn't getting paid. He was fighting back then.
Yeah.
It's like, really?
Crazy,
and
right?
And we're like, it's just Muhammad.
Yeah.
Even like, Bob, you know? And that's something I want to learn more about, because for me, Bob is one of my greatest inspirations, but it's like, he was a wild football player, too.
I didn't know that. Bob Marley, yeah?
Yeah.
Soccer, yeah?
Soccer, football.
Yeah. Even you, you're South American, we call it football, innit?
Yeah.
These fucking Americans, they fucking change. Hey, soccer.
We'll find a middle ground, but I think it's wild that there's always room to be yourself and give your contribution to the world.
Nice. What's your second favorite sport outside jiu-jitsu or even MMA, say, like, as a whole? What else do you like? Soccer, basketball, or not really? You're just...
Surf and skate.
Surfing and skating, dope. Nice. Okay, man. Yes, bro, it's crazy how you're only 23 as well. And you've been to so many places. You say right now you don't have a permanent place. You keep going from place to place. Tell the people, where have you been?
Man, I've been nomading the past 5 years.
Yeah.
So I've really been between Vegas, Miami, Houston, and Ecuador. Mostly Ruta del Sol on the coast. So I stay going between those places.
Yeah.
Kind of like I had this conversation before with other athletes. Is like, how the fuck you doing this shit? Like, because everyone else that I know fighting at this level has a room full of other monsters.
Yeah.
Like I'm usually the only one that's in there trying to like do it.
Yeah.
But that, I think that goes to show what we're capable of.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and what's on the way. It's cool doing the nomad thing, but you definitely need to learn how to do it right.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, so I think I haven't been able to show my full potential. But there's other things that I've been able to catch caught onto on the way that, you know, we're sharing now and bringing it all together. Because I'm coming from a place of, you know, just fight, train, yeah. Fight, sleep, train, yeah, fight, yeah. Sleep. And then you do anything else outside of that, that's weird, bro.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
What are you doing?
You know? Yeah, yeah. And it's actually interesting what you brought up, because I've actually noticed there's a lot of people who they train at big gyms, like you said, there's full of monsters. It's like knife sharpened knives, right? But then you see other people like yourself, like Israel Adesanya, for example. Even I can name even like the middleweight champion right now, Duplessis, and they're not really from big gyms. They come from small gyms. Do you think there's both positives and negatives that come from both sides?
I think it's the individual that makes it happen.
Happen, okay.
It's the individual that makes it happen, because there's if it's something that I know, like there's some people want to do it, some people feel like they're here to do it. If you have that feeling and you go, and you say, there's no excuse. I don't care how long it takes, I'm going to make it.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter whether you have a big team or a small team. Even if you don't have any equipment, you know. I prepared for fights training outside, like in the street, while I'm traveling.
Yeah, yeah.
Shadow drilling by myself. So when I get to see a mat room or a couple people, even if they're not pro athletes, I'm like, yes.
That's a privilege, yeah.
Yeah, because it, you know, everybody's story is different, but
yeah, yeah.
You just have to fill in the blanks and put your seasoning to it. That's what martial arts really is,
and find what works for you, right? Because like we said as well, we know champions that come from small gyms, perhaps in a smaller gym, they can put more focus onto you. And there's people that, like, you know, like Sean Strickland, for example, the MMA fighter at a big gym, where like it's full of monsters and he loves sparring every day. And you know, like even in MMA, and you have people like Adesanya, he's like, I would never spar like that every day. Like, that's insanity to me. For me, I'd rather just have fun and enjoy it. And I've seen that kind of mentality from you when it comes to jiu-jitsu. If you're not having a good time on the mats, it's not really for you, right?
Yeah, I like both.
Yeah, okay, cool.
Because I do feel like I'm from like the culture I grew up in, whether it was intentional or not, like how I grew up was train.
Yeah.
Be quiet, train. Be quiet, yeah, yeah, yeah. Train, eat right. Like, so for I got used to that and I like it.
Yeah.
Like I remember I see some pictures back in the day where I'm after practice and I have the coldest face of it. I'm so happy. Like, I swear. So I've been like, that's one thing I've been able to express myself a lot more with the sport. I'm a bit more like, all right, I don't have to be so loud when I get to talk. I'll be myself. But I think that as long as you, if you love what you're doing, you're going to figure things out to make it, you know, presentable and also pliable.
Correct. What do you like doing outside MMA apart from, jiu-jitsu apart from surfing and skating? Do you like doing like video games? Because I saw when you was young, you liked video games. Do you still play video games?
I used to. I don't play as much anymore, but Dragon Ball Z and Naruto were my jam.
Your jam,
I like
yeah.
adventure fighting games.
Okay. I'm a little older than you, so for me it was Pokemon.
Pokemon.
So Pokemon was my shit. And then I remember actually after Pokemon, it was kind of Dragon Ball Z era. All my younger cousins loved it. I was going to ask, why do you fight? But I think that just answers, you was born into it, right? You had no choice.
You know what the wild thing about that is that I was born into it, but I chose to continue after certain, you know, after a certain age. It was kind of like jiu-jitsu was my family's business. Now I feel like I'm the one continuing that along with my brother, because anything I'm doing now is not possible without my brother. The past 2 years he has been my main training partner.
Yeah,
you know, so I have to give credit to my brother Matias.
Yeah.
And there was one moment where I was like 12, 13, right before I really liked it, I'd always be like, yo, let me just stay at the house. I want to go play American football today.
Yeah.
You know? So after a while, my dad was like, all right, because, man, he was, you know, I have to give credit to my dad because dude is tough. You know, he goes into the, he's from Ecuador, going to the U.S., doesn't have the best English at the moment, at that time, but still willing to do whatever he needs to. He was working like 3 jobs, security, selling cars, construction, personal trainer. I remember him doing all that shit at the same time.
Yeah.
And running a gym. And going, driving like an hour or so to train with other athletes so that he can have someone to train with, because there's only kids and people that work in offices here.
Yeah.
You know, he didn't have that technique at that moment. He had to start himself.
Yeah.
So I didn't know all that stuff. But to me, it was like, fuck, my dad just got to the house. I just got to the house from school and all that thing. So I just want to chill. I want to go play outside. I want to see the trees. And after a while of like a couple of days of doing that, I was like, damn, we're not doing nothing out here. These kids, they don't know what they're doing either. I don't know what I'm doing out here. So I might as well spend that extra 2 hours to go practice and listen to my, like, I'll listen to my dad, who's doing something that he's able to do. He's able to show this to kids that are not his. So there's gotta be something
beneficial.
Good.
Yeah.
You know, like I come from a place where like you don't trust everybody with your kid.
Yeah.
You know, from Ecuador is like.
Are you first gen?
For what?
Like your parents were born here or?
I was the first one
here. Yeah, I'm the same as well, like in the UK. And like you said, my father sounds similar to your father, and that's why I say to people, like, there's no excuses in life. Like, there's people, like, my dad was like your dad, like, come over, shit English. But they made it happen one way or another. Do you get what I'm saying? And I'm not saying, like, my dad was rich or anything or well off, but they survived. They were able to do it. So, and that's why I feel a lot of the Western civilization is declining, because we don't have that same mentality that our parents used to have of working hard to get what you want no more. Everyone wants to be a fucking... I know this sounds hypocritical because we're doing an interview, but everyone wants to be a YouTuber, podcaster. Obviously, people know I do things outside this, but everyone just wants to do something that they think's easy these days, not what willing to put the work in.
There's so many options nowadays.
There is.
And at the end of the day, it's like, it's that fulfillment that's gonna... It's gonna clear out all those options and give you, instead of 112, you have really two.
Yeah, plan A and plan B, that's it, yeah. So big up Matias Jimenez, big up the brother, big up your father, and also your mother was a motivator as well, right?
Mom,
yeah.
She deserves a lot more credit than she's gotten. She's a rock, man. She's, when my pops was traveling for his fights, she held it down, take me to if I needed to go somewhere for practice, she'd be there. And she's also a black belt herself.
Oh, no way. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
No way. That's interesting, man. That's cool. Didn't know that. Okay, yeah, because when I watched your documentary, I saw you, obviously, when your dad was out there competing, your mum was, like, your motivator. And at times where you wanted, not give up, but, you know, in times where you was down on the sport, she was ready to pick you back up. So, yeah.
Yeah, and my sister, I have to give a shout-out to my sister, Monique. I know she's gonna watch this, so
yeah. Is she a black belt as well?
No, she's 8.
Okay.
Jiu-jitsu takes a while,
yeah.
But she was born and I left school, so 2015 I left school just to do jiu-jitsu and help with the family business. We don't have the gym here in North America anymore. My dad has a spot out in Allange, Ecuador.
Okay,
if you're out there for the beach, go get some rounds.
Go check it out.
And I had to finish up. That's really why I stopped wanting to, like, avoid practice. It's because I wanna really, like, come. I got into jiu-jitsu and then I saw how everything was, like, you know, that's kind of a highlight of my life was when my whole family was doing jiu-jitsu, as in, like, my household that I come from, that I originated from.
Yeah.
And I think it'd be cool for everybody to have something like that at least once in their life with their family. Like, it doesn't have to be jiu-jitsu.
Jiu-jitsu, but it has to be something that you guys can bond over and build towards. Yeah, I agree with you, man. 100%. And talking of Ecuador as well, obviously we saw Chito Vera fight a couple of weeks ago, a fucking tough fight. Honestly, I kind of saw it coming, man. Sugar O'Malley is definitely, like, elite striker. It was unfortunate for Chito. Fucking durable, bro. I don't know if you watched the fight.
It was crazy. It was like, yeah. Man, I really thought Chito was going to win this one.
Yeah.
But it's it also showed Chito's heart.
Oh, bro, he's so tough. That knee, there's no one in that division that would have took that knee and stayed standing, bro. That was insane.
Like,
there's probably middleweights and, like, light heavyweights that would have took that knee and probably dropped that. That's a knee in your head. But also, he caught him. Did you see on the last second, he caught Sugar with a body shot? And Chito, and then Sugar after the fight was kneeling down trying to recover. And he actually admitted it after the fight, and he said, yeah, Chito knocked the wind out of me the last second of the fight.
Man.
Yeah, so yeah, man, Chito was tough. I would have liked to see him just be more risky. But you know what? From what I learned after, he had a lot on his head going into the fight as well. His house got burgled that same day.
Really?
He found out before the fight. So, you know, I'm not making excuses for him, but that's definitely going to fuck with your mental state, knowing that your house being robbed and you have to go fight. You don't know what's being robbed. You don't know what's being taken. Do you know what I'm saying? And it's fucking horrible, people touching your fucking personal belongings. So,
right.
Yeah. You ever met Chito?
Yeah. You met him? Nice. Chito, nice. A couple times. Yeah, Chito's cool. I hope we can link up, get some training in.
Yeah.
But, you know, I think he's in a place where he can make it back to get that title, and he can get it.
No, he can.
He can get it.
Yeah.
But regardless, Chito has been able to, you know, bring Ecuador into the spotlight of this sport.
100%.
You know? So, yeah. And that's really cool for... It inspires a lot of athletes out in Ecuador.
Yeah.
And it's only helped grow the sport out there.
So. I know. And I didn't realize, but I actually done more investigation into it. And Chito Vera is actually very good friends with the Ecuadorian president, right?
I don't know.
Oh, you don't know that? So my understanding, my research is that Chito helped the president get into position because Chito is such a big figure in Ecuador. That he loved this candidate, and the candidate is now the president. So yeah, he's good friends with the president as well. I'm honestly quite conservative myself, and when I asked, the person who I was talking to was an Ecuadorian friend of mine, and he was saying, yeah, the president's really good. He cares a lot about the country, and we can't say that for all presidents around the world.
So, I don't know much about
the politics.
No, not at all. Yeah. All I know is that, you know, I hope the best for Ecuador because it's a beautiful place.
Yeah.
It's a beautiful place. The nature out there, everybody can, you know, it's one of those places you want to protect.
Yeah, yeah.
Galapagos. I love Ecuador.
Yeah, man, I definitely need to visit. As soon as I get myself out of here, I'm going to go Mexico, Ecuador, definitely places in South America I want to visit. I even heard Brazil is beautiful. Talking of Brazil, let's get on some jiu-jitsu. So your favorite BJJ submission, is it the rear naked, would you say?
Rear naked? Yeah.
Yeah. You've got so many finishes from the rear naked, yeah.
Man, and I feel like people know what to do. Even if you don't know jiu-jitsu, you know what that choke is.
Yeah.
So it feels natural.
Okay. And what would you say is your jiu-jitsu style? What would you call it? How would you... describe your style of jiu-jitsu, your style.
Free flow.
I would say the same. Electric.
Electric.
Alkaline, like that's that. Right. do you enjoy teaching jiu-jitsu?
I love teaching jiu-jitsu.
You love it, yeah.
I feel like that's one thing I felt this past 2 years is not having a gym. It's cool to be able to train more. It's definitely helped me develop a lot. But that's why I stay doing seminars, because I love teaching.
Teaching, yeah.
You know, and I like seeing someone learn the technique.
Yeah,
you could do it.
It's true. And do you think also teaching it kind of builds up your memory to like learn that move better yourself? Teaching it,
would
you
say? Almost definitely, because I can't show you something that doesn't work.
Yeah.
You're gonna look, it doesn't work. I'm like, no, we're gonna make it work because I know what we're doing.
Correct. How do you approach, what's your approach to discipline and motivation when it comes to jiu-jitsu?
Discipline and motivation? Yeah. I think both are important, but discipline is always going to topple motivation.
100%.
But motivation is there to this is what I'm going for. But whether that's there or not, I have to do this to even get there.
Correct. That's put it very well. Because I agree, I think motivation can help you with the end goal, vision, where you need to be. But at the end of the day, the discipline's the number one thing, because even if you don't feel like doing it, it doesn't fucking matter, you fucking do it. Because that, you know, the days that you don't feel like doing it are probably the most important days, right?
Man, it's gonna rain whether we like it or not, so we might as well be ready for it.
That's right. And your first BJJ gym, where was it? First time training, obviously was with your family in Ecuador, right?
So the first gym that I trained at was Bidokan, and that was the first jiu-jitsu gym in Ecuador.
In Ecuador, okay, cool. And you got gold at 13, was your first time you got gold, right?
About 13.
13, yeah. Any other jiu-jitsu guys who inspire you? You said you named some of the legends before, some of the old school guys. What about any other current guys?
Current, I would say more like respect.
Yeah.
Respect. Definitely. Victor Hugo, Fabricio Andre, the Rutolos, Musumeci, and This is from, you know, jiu-jitsu. That's respect.
Yeah, yeah.
You know?
And I'm guessing your proudest moment in jiu-jitsu was the IBJJF?
It's one of.
Yeah.
One of. I feel like, I don't know if I've reached that moment yet, but for me, a highlight is definitely that one.
That one, yeah.
And there's a couple world titles at the other belts that is just like, man, I could tell you a whole story behind those.
Yeah. Yeah. Tell us one. Or is it too long?
I mean, I can, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, go on. Give us one.
Like, first time I won worlds as an adult, yeah. I was 18. I had just turned 18 like 2 weeks prior. And I went in for a training session like a week and a half before the worlds in the gi, 2018. And this dude, Julio Orantes, he gets a footlock on me and then just pops my foot. I didn't want to tap. He was, you know, it's just something that happens in practice.
Yeah, like, yeah. If
two athletes about to fight worlds, you know, you just got to be extra careful.
Yeah, yeah.
I was too wild in the movement. I didn't tap. So I couldn't walk at all for, like, at least a week about. And, like, the 2 days before we were going to drive from Vegas to Cali for Worlds, I was like, man, if I'm able to walk, I'm going. I'm fighting. Yeah. I don't care. So then, you know, I guess I have to give credit to what helped me out was I was, you know, I don't smoke all the time. I'll take long breaks because I do like being clear-headed for training, to wake up early, all this stuff.
Yeah.
If I have to do an interview or something. But I was smoking a lot then because I was like, fuck, I don't know if pain. I can even stand up. So I might as well just smoke. And I showed up. And I remember thinking once I got to Worlds at the Pyramid and here in Long Beach.
Yeah.
I just thought, I don't know. But today's a good day. Today's going to be a good day.
Yeah.
And I went in there and I did 10 fights, 10 submissions. I think. So each fight's supposed to be 7 minutes max.
Yeah.
I don't think I was on the mat for more than 30 minutes, if that.
Combined.
Yeah, combined.
Yeah. It's crazy.
And overall, it was kind of just like, I was losing all year. I was losing all year as in like, I'd make it to the final, semifinal, you know. But then this one that I'm like, oh, I don't even know if I'm going to be able to fight worlds.
Yeah.
I go in there and it was a great outcome. And I was just, I knew it was going to be a good day. You know, you get up sometimes.
It. Yeah, yeah. And you know.
You know if it's going to be a tough day. You know if it's going to be a good day. And the other one for me is also when I've had a tough day. Where I'm like, fuck, today's been a tough day. Go in there and fight. Make it happen.
Yeah.
It's just being in the moment.
Nice. So you heard it, guys. 2 weeks before, popped his foot. You was 1 week out just able to walk.
Yeah, same thing for Nogi Worlds, to be honest. Like the day before the final.
Yeah.
I in the absolute, I fought Francisco Lo. He had a footlock on me.
Yeah.
And my foot popped. Like it was, my foot was huge.
Yeah, yeah.
Like a potato, like was on top of it. And the next day, I woke up, I couldn't walk, but I just showed up and I had to fight. I lost the weight class by points, but then in the absolute, I kind of put my brain back together and I was like, all right, fuck it. You know, we're already here. Let's go. And I was able to fight the final, but the next day I wasn't walking much.
Yeah, crazy. Yeah. Would you say that Gordon's the strongest guy you've ever felt on the mat?
No. Bushesha.
Bushesha, yeah. Okay, cool. What advice would you give somebody thinking about starting jiu-jitsu?
Be patient.
Patience.
Be patient. And how do I put this into words? Don't be scared to figure it out. don't be scared to figure it out, because if you're waiting for someone to walk you through it the whole time, it's going to take a long time.
Yeah.
But if you're patient and you, okay, let me figure this out, and you're patient with it, it's going to be a fun one.
Yeah. It's probably something I need to work on personally. I'm not the most patient guy, so I definitely need to work on my patience. So yeah, you said your favorite submission was a rear naked choke, but also you do love doing triangles and arm bars as well. Obviously, they are submissions that are quite unpopular in jiu-jitsu.
I don't mean to cut you off.
Yeah, go ahead.
I at this point, I love jiu-jitsu.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, it could be, I could get an Americana.
Yeah.
I got the Americana.
Yeah, yeah.
I took the back.
Yeah, yeah.
I just love jiu-jitsu.
Well, I've seen you do some flying triangles as well.
Yeah, flying stuff.
Yeah, that's insane.
the insane part is practicing it.
Yeah.
Finding someone that's like, okay, can you hold on to me real quick?
Yeah. Is there any submissions that you want to execute that you haven't executed yet that you've maybe got in the, or maybe you don't want to say, maybe we'll just say it offset.
Well, you'll see it.
Yeah, I'll see it. Okay, cool. Nice. I don't know if you want to answer this one. You seem like a really like kind guy, but yeah, I'm going to ask it either way. Most overrated guy in jiu-jitsu.
Most overrated?
Yeah. Is this a call out?
Most overrated person in jiu-jitsu. I'm going to be honest. There's a couple. There's a couple overrated people in jiu-jitsu just because we all come from very similar cultures. Like, you can't, we come from the same culture. Like, you can't go around it from some people, you know? We can notice that there's some things that we can do better.
Yeah.
But I don't know. There's a couple of them, you know? There's a couple of them. I would say... You know what? I'm going to go ahead and do it.
Yeah?
Yeah. I think Medagali has been overrated recently. He's definitely deserves respect for his jiu-jitsu.
Yeah.
But I seen this dude back in the day, and his persona was a lot different. And I think his jiu-jitsu has improved regardless. So I respect Medagali's jiu-jitsu, but... I think it's a bit overrated.
Overhyped.
Yeah, because his jiu-jitsu was good regardless of what he's been doing recently in the media and stuff.
Yeah.
So I think that's an example of someone who has great jiu-jitsu.
Yeah.
And, you know, you can choose to do whatever you want outside of that, but we're going to focus on the jiu-jitsu part, so
respect
on that and, you know, Don't have to say more than you have to.
That's it. Fair enough, man. If you were to go to a battle against 20 unarmed men, yeah? No guns, no knives, 20 men. And you had to pick 3 jiu-jitsu guys to come with you. Who are you picking?
3 jiu-jitsu guys? Wait. 20 unarmed?
Yeah, 20 unarmed guys. You guys are going in a fight against them. You have to pick 3 jiu-jitsu guys. Any 3 jiu-jitsu guys.
But it's a fight.
Yeah, like, it's a fight, yeah.
It's not jiu-jitsu
fight. No, but you got to pick 3 jiu-jitsu guys.
Fight, yeah. Okay. Well, Bushesha.
Yeah.
Man, that's... who else? I would choose... Vinny Magalhães.
Yeah.
If you know Vinny Magalhães, and it's a legit fight.
Big guy, innit? A steroid guy, innit?
Yeah, but he's an MMA fighter.
Yeah. That's why, yeah.
And one more fight like that. Man. Verdum.
Verdum. Yeah, it's a beast. You pick the guys who can also throw hands as well, yeah. All right, cool. Well, now we're going to go to the UFC fighters. How about if you had to pick 3 UFC fighters?
3 UFC fighters?
Well, let's say MMA. Let's say MMA so you can pick every MMA
fighters.
Yeah.
Izzy.
Yeah.
Alex.
Pereira.
Pereira. and Ngannou.
Ngannou, yeah. Do you know what? Mine are similar to yours. So mine would have been John Jones, Ngannou. John Jones, Ngannou, and probably Tom Aspinall. Do you know who Tom Aspinall is? He's the heavyweight, UFC heavyweight champion right now. Yeah, he's from the UK. He has incredible jiu-jitsu, actually. Do you know what? I actually have I have links with him. So when he comes over here, it'll be dope to get you guys to link up as well, man.
Yeah, I'm with him.
Yeah,
man,
and he's one of those guys who will never touch roids. He like lives by it.
Really?
Yeah. But UFC fighters get tested, but I know like you can still get around it, but you can look at Tom Aspinall's body and tell he's not on roids anyway. But
I respect that.
Yeah, he's known a lot for his wrestling. He's got good striking as well, but they're saying he's gonna fight the winner of John Jones and Stipe, so let's see how that. I think he's gonna beat John Jones personally.
And that'd be an incredible fight.
Yeah. Do you do strength? Do you incorporate a lot of strength training for your jiu-jitsu as well?
Yeah. So I feel like that's something I've trained with several people in the past. One person who's helped me out, two people have helped me out a lot in the past was Kevin Parati, KP. He's he was Lucas Celebrity's trainer for a long time. And I got in touch with KP through Lucas back in the day. And while I've been in Vegas, Jolene, a family friend of ours, has been helping me out. But I feel like there's I'll do certain, like, just make up workouts that, like, even if I follow the program step by step, I always feel like there has to be a little extra that I have to do that I've really enjoyed coming up with. Or like learning about strength training.
Yeah.
You know, strength conditioning, because you got to do Olympic weightlifting. You got to do bodybuilding a little bit to keep up with toning up the body. You got to do calisthenics.
I was going to say calisthenics is very important as well, right?
Plyometrics. It's not like, because ideally, I want to be going at a high speed for however long I have to.
Yeah.
Even if that's like an hour. You know, like I used to run as fast as I could for an hour.
Fucking hell.
And that shit is tiring.
Yeah.
So that's ideally that's what I'm looking to do in the fight, is keep a high pace. But it's moving somebody who's like 40 pounds heavier than me.
Yeah.
So we're still, I'll talk with my trainer and then we come up with plans. But yeah, strength and conditioning is a huge part. Even if I wasn't doing jiu-jitsu, I really enjoy that.
Yeah,
but
yeah,
as you know, what I do, it's one of my key components to be able to perform.
Strength training. Yeah, man. And gi or no gi?
Both.
Both. You like both, yeah. Okay, we spoke about the alkaline diet. So did you already know about Dr. Sebi? I'm guessing way before you even met Victor, right?
Yeah. Yeah, I was out in New York actually, and a friend mentioned, I was thinking back then, 2018, I want to do 2019, something about that. I want to go plant-based. I saw that movie, the Game Changer movie.
Yeah.
So I was like, I'm going to try to do plant-based. And then a friend was like, try alkaline. It's similar, but here, look up Dr. Sebi. This is his son on Instagram. And then I started doing research, and I'm like, you know, his dad is speaking truth right
here.
You know? Dr. Sebi knows what he's talking about. And it's simple. If you like listen to what he's saying, it makes sense.
Yeah.
So I was hesitant at first. But then I started doing the research and trying out, and the results speak for themselves.
Yeah, man. And that's what I tell people on the alkaline diet anyway. Like, you can do your research, go do your research yourself. But also, once you start incorporating the whole lifestyle in, you'll see how better you feel yourself. More energy, stronger, better skin, endless amounts of positives. Strategies to actually talking of alkaline as well, do you have any favorite alkaline meals or any favorite, we'll start with the meals. What's your favorite alkaline meal to have?
Man, I always do this. I haven't had it in a while. I might actually do it. You reminded me. I'll get coconut milk.
Okay.
Right. Throw some seasoning in there, like onion powder, cayenne pepper, salt, chickpeas.
Yeah.
Oyster mushrooms.
Yeah.
Let it boil.
Okay.
Simmer. And it's kind of like a stew, but it's chickpeas with mushrooms. And what else?
Would you make a grain for that? Like a quinoa it's or like wild rice? It's like a soup. Okay, yeah. okay.
That's why I throw the chickpeas in there.
In there, yeah.
They get soft. And then
all right.
The mushrooms are chewy because they've been soaking up the coconut milk.
Yeah, yeah.
Man, it's like a comfort soup.
Soup. Okay, I'm going to have to give it a try. I'm going to have to give it a try. And about fruit, what's your favorite fruit?
Cherimoya.
I love cherimoya. My favorite is seeded watermelon. I'm waiting for the season to come again, but yeah. Strategies to employ to ensure safety during training sessions. That's a big one I need to definitely ask you because I see a lot of injuries happening in jiu-jitsu gyms. I've got injured a few times doing jiu-jitsu. What would be your advice like to try and avoid injuries?
Know your training partners and we all need those. I mean, it's because there's two sides of jiu-jitsu, right? Jiu-jitsu is one of those sports where you're either an athlete or you want to become an athlete, or you just love jiu-jitsu and you want to do it.
Yeah.
So you have to have that clear first. And then everyone, no matter what, can all perform at the highest level of jiu-jitsu, whether you're a pro athlete or not. That's something that people need to know that too.
Yeah.
But to be able to avoid injuries is really like kind of learn from my mistake. Don't go crazy. It's just a training session.
Yeah.
And if you want to really defend a submission, like an attack, don't let someone get it. Right. Yeah. It's a bit more detailed than how it sounds, but it's really like that.
Yeah.
Like a good defense is not letting them get that. That doesn't mean not fight. That doesn't mean don't move. But it's okay, if somebody's going for your arm bar, right? You need to clear the elbow.
Yeah.
There's no elbow. There's no arm bar.
Arm bar. Yeah.
They're attacking your leg. You have to clear the feet and the knee.
Yeah.
Because you can clear your knee, but they still got your foot.
Feet, yeah.
You know, so you get those like basic things down. And like I said, be patient and figure it out. Like, okay, so I need to defend myself and I want to win by either having better positions or finishing the fight. So three things: positions, defense, and attacking.
Yeah.
You know, you bring it to those and you don't have to worry as much about injuries.
Yeah. When a lot of times what I've done, I would say majority of my work that I've done in jiu-jitsu is like 78% defense. Mm-hmm. That's what I like to learn first. I think it's best to learn defense rather than attacks because, one, I like it because I can strike, so I like to just get back on my feet. But in general, I think it's better to learn defense, get out, like you said, not get into bad positions or learn to get out of bad positions rather than learning attacks. I think a lot of people in jiu-jitsu, straight away, they just want to learn attacks. Oh, bro, teach me triangle, teach me an arm bar, teach me that. And it's like, I think defense is more important at the beginning to learn than attacks.
For sure.
Yeah.
That goes with knowing your training partners. Because you know the training partners, so you can practice your defense, you can practice your attacks, right? And then a good training partner, you can do all of that with.
With, yeah. What's the freakiest injury that you've ever seen on the mats?
Ooh.
Probably you've seen some crazy shit, right?
Man, Homulo Bahal.
Yeah.
One time at Worlds, I think it was in the semifinal or in the final, I'm not sure. But that was the highlight of that Worlds. Was he did not tap. He got in the toe hold and his foot was dangling at the end, but he didn't tap.
Yeah.
Not that I remember. It was just like That's the gnarliest I've seen. It's just a hanging foot. And dude's a legend.
Fucking hell, crazy. Favorite place to travel outside Ecuador?
Man, you're exposing me. Man, I love the beach.
Yeah.
It could be Brazil or Hawaii. Those okay. two are the ones that come to mind.
Nice. I've never been to Hawaii, but I'm planning to go in like July. Beautiful.
Amazing.
Yeah. Yeah. All right, definitely need to go. Dream destination that you've never been to?
Bali.
Bali. Okay.
Not yet.
Yeah, yeah. Not been to, yeah. Do you listen to music when you train?
Man, that's an important part of my life is music. So I really love reggae and mostly reggae, but also, you know, rap, hip hop, and because they are all from the same branch.
Yeah.
But recently I've been getting into listening a lot to, I was listening back to my old days, like Rage Against the Machine. I think it's funny how we live in a moment in life where there was a time where it was kind of like that, the song that fuck you, I won't do what you tell me. Oh, yeah.
Who's that again? Rage Against the Machine?
Rage Against the Machine?
No, I've never.
Rage Against the Machine?
No, I've never heard
really?
Him.
Really?
Yeah.
Brother.
Definitely need to research him. For you heard
sure.
him? No? Okay.
No way. No. Man.
Austin, what about you? Oh, them lot sleeping.
It's yeah. all good. Yeah. Check out Rage Against the Machine. It's yeah. just like, imagine reggae, but rock.
Oh, okay.
That's how I think of it.
Okay. Dude. I love reggae as well. I grew up to a lot of reggae as well. We'll listen to some in a little bit. But yeah, so when you're training, would you say more hip hop when you're training? Like more upbeat?
It mix.
Mix. Okay.
We'll have hip hop, reggae, or funk.
Funk, yeah.
Or even like bachata, salsa. Yeah, yeah. Like the Spanish. And I just started recently. I started more like getting in touch with that music. I liked it always, but like it brings back memories of being on the beach and like dancing or being with someone, you know. Yeah. And that is also really good for training because it's like you're
rhythm.
Dancing.
Rhythm. I agree with you 100%. And you know what? It kind of reminded me of what you said to me offset as well. But you said in Ecuador, you see a family doing handstands, walking around, and they were getting ready to do capoeira, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was one of my earliest memories.
That's crazy.
I think it was like the two kids and the two parents, and they were just doing like a duck. Like, you know how ducks will go in a line?
Yeah.
It was just like so perfectly aligned. It was just a family going through handstanding around the whole place.
Crazy. That's the future, man. I'm gonna do that with all my children and all my wives.
Yeah, imagine families just like eating
alkaline,
the right things. Yeah. So that they can do fun things.
Yeah, that's what I want to do. That's how I want to build my family for sure. If you had to name three of your favorite musicians,
oh,
Bob, do you reckon Bob's definitely in there?
Bob,
yeah,
Bob Marley. Nipsey Hussle.
Nipsey.
And Canserbero.
Okay. Big up Nipsey, man, as well. Rest in peace, Nips. What is the craziest submission you've ever executed? Was it the flying triangle?
I don't know.
Buggy choke?
Well, I mean, yeah. I've hit flying triangles, yeah. Flying arm bars. I don't know. I feel like I've done something maybe crazier than that, but I can't remember. I did I think what's crazy is probably like how I got to the submission.
Yeah.
Like I'd be in a bad position and out of nowhere, like I got the back with the choke already, like, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
But
yeah.
I think that's really what makes the submission crazy. Like what How did you get there?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, like, and that, you're right, because a lot of times in jiu-jitsu, it's not so much about how crazy the submission is, but it's the movement to get to the submission, how quick it happens and the flow of it. And it's like, yeah, it's nothing that the opposition can do when it happens, like, you know.
But the flying attacks are golden because it's harder to do that in the higher levels.
Yeah. I would say even, like, do you think, like, yourself, if you, like, had a white belt, you could always get a flying triangle on them?
No, because I would break their knees.
Okay. Because you got hold from...
They have to know how to catch you.
Okay, cool.
See what I'm saying? So yeah. There has to be, like, a certain level. For me, I'm not going to do a flying armbar on someone, even if I could. But I know that they're not going to be able to catch me.
Yeah.
Right? Because I don't want to hurt that person's knee. If I have a heel hook or a knee bar, we're fighting, it's a tournament, that's different. There's a ref. And not only that, if I set it up right, you might not even have to let me break your leg. You feel it like, oh no, you're going to break it if you pull it.
Pull it, yeah.
You know? So, yeah, flying attack is doable. Even in practice, in my opinion, with the right people.
Yeah.
And not everybody can handle more than 150 pounds of somebody flying at you. Yeah. Some people can.
So. Yeah. Actually, my ex-girlfriend, I got her into jiu-jitsu and she's about to get her blue belt. She's competing right now as we talk in England. She's like a gold champion. But what do you feel like? Do you feel like a black belt woman would be majority of white belt men or not?
Yes.
Yes?
Definitely. Okay.
You say that, yeah? Because I used to date a girl who was a purple belt. She was a champion in purple belt. She's quite a big girl as well. Not fat, but she's taller than me. But yeah, she's strong, let's say. But she was a purple belt. But whenever like I could like have like little instances with her, I could always feel like if I really wanted to, I could probably put her...
You know, you gotta be realistic as well.
Yeah.
Right? Like if we're talking technique wise.
Yeah. They'll have better technique but power than
for
ever.
For sure. It's just that's kind of where we need to like learn from each other. It's kind of, you know, we have a lot of power.
Yeah.
But just because we have a lot of power doesn't mean we have a lot of technique.
Yeah.
Think about
true.
That with things in life.
Yeah.
Right? Because we a lot of times, like, we're men, we do this. Yeah. But then it's like, look at the details. Look
true.
How things are being done. Who focuses on the details? The women.
Yeah.
Right? And that's how men are considered usually, like, more like, how do I say? They're feminine and masculine energy, right?
Yeah.
Well, when you do something where it's very detailed, you're in touch with that feminine energy.
Yeah.
That's, yeah.
And it's an interesting take what you said, and it's very true because women do focus on small details. Even if you send a picture to a girl, she'll see small things in the picture, like a little book that's on the side or something like that. We're not like that as men. So it's interesting in this, actually it's true what you said. We tend to focus on power, aggression and stuff like that, and women, a small detail, so you probably can learn a lot from technique from a woman then.
Most definitely.
Yeah.
But there's I think jiu-jitsu shows and that if we're looking at it from that point of view, from the details point of view, I mean, yeah, we definitely, because you know, if, how do I explain this, I have to have a little bit of both, right? Because I can be the most technical, but if I don't have a little bit of like, I need to get it done.
Yeah.
You know? So, yeah, I feel like jiu-jitsu is one of those things where you're going to have to deal with both of those energies as an individual, like your feminine and your masculine.
Yeah.
And yeah, women are very detailed. So be careful when you roll with women.
Yeah, I've never been tapped out by a woman. All right, Ethan, shh. All right, cool. He's like, you will. yeah, I've never been tapped out by a woman yet. I've even rolled with a black belt, actually. At my jiu-jitsu gym, there's a black belt girl. I'm not going to lie, I felt like I could tap her if I wanted to, but I didn't try. It was kind of, we were drilling over things, but... Maybe she could, man. I don't know. It would be interesting to see in the future. But yeah, it would definitely motivate me. I would probably definitely be hurt by my ego inside if I got tapped by a girl.
You'll see how technical you are.
Yeah, it's true. What's the next step for Roberto Jimenez?
Man, right now, we got some things coming up. We got to confirm some details first, but you know, you can catch me training. You can catch me training. I got to give a shout out to everybody who's been supporting our brand, Natural Clothing. We do a couple alkaline things and jiu-jitsu gear, streetwear. So we're just, you know, that's what I've been doing recently, really.
The merch.
The merch. I do a lot of things. So I'm training, I'm studying, setting up fights, setting up seminars, camps, going over the stuff for the brand. I develop half pretty much the process of the designs and everything else that goes into, like, you know, the pack, sending the stuff out, getting the stuff in. I do most of that on myself, you know. I have my family that helps me out with it.
Yeah.
But yeah.
Bro, the merchandise is amazing. I'm going to order some of the rash guards. The rash guards are really nice as well. Also, I was going to say, where can people find that? Where can people find all your merch?
You can check it out on thenaturaleffectpodcast. You can go to my Instagram link bio.
Thenaturaleffectpodcast, and you can find it on his Instagram as well. And what are you studying right now, Roberto? You said you're also studying.
Studying
in general.
Overall, yeah. Like, I've been out of school. I checked out of school at 15, but yeah. I've been checked out of school since 12.
Yeah.
So I figured out I want to keep learning.
Yeah.
You can go on YouTube and do 30 minutes to an hour and learn something really cool every day.
100%. We're all students of life, man. Even billionaires, like, that's the whole mentality to have. Even when you're a billionaire, there's still something to learn every single day that's new. Like, even, for example, billionaires could sit here at the table and learn things about jiu-jitsu from you, learn about nutrition from us. Do you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And I'm sure there's things that they can teach us that we don't know. So,
Definitely. You know, like you said, iron sharp as iron.
Yeah. And guys, you guys heard it, where to find him. Looking forward for your journey, man. It's like I said, I know you feels like you're an OG in the game, but you're so young still. Like, it's gonna be crazy. Before you go, I'm gonna ask you a two answer questionnaire. I'll give you two answers. Just pick one out of the two, okay? Okay, Ferrari or Lambo? I know you don't like materials, but if you had to pick, if someone was to give you a free Lambo or free Ferrari, which one would you pick?
Lambo.
Private jet or yacht?
What was that?
Private jet or yacht? Like a boat, a big boat.
Man, that's a tough one because I love the ocean.
Yeah, I love the ocean.
I think, yet.
Yeah, I would pick the same. LA or Miami?
Miami. Yeah. I love both, but I was born in Miami, you know?
Yeah. So. He's repping the 305, but I'm from, like, I'm an LA boy, but I would still tell you Miami's better than LA. I love LA, but Miami is just something different, especially right now, right?
Hey, bro.
It's crazy out there.
There's a vibe out there.
The women, the weather, the beaches, even the alkaline food out there is amazing. Yeah, there's so many spots.
It's tropical.
It is real tropical, man. One woman or multiple?
Hey, man, don't do me like that.
That's why I asked you if you had a girlfriend at the beginning. I didn't want to put you on the spot, but seeing as you don't, then...
Right now, you know, I'm...
No, Miss Jimenez.
I'm doing me, so, you know, we can do 2, 3, whatever.
Okay, so, yeah. Well, that's what I say on Girls Night. That's basically another thing I say on Girls Night, that if every man in the world had it their way, even the guys who are in, like, relationships, monogamous relationships, if their wife turned around and said, I know how men are, I won't judge you, you can go out there and sleep with other women, every single man without the
other. Almost definitely. But then, you know, that's a whole battle. You know, it's something that's where communication comes in play.
Correct.
And also, like, maturity.
Yeah,
There's levels to that. And I think, because I've, you know, I'm 23, but I've lived. So I think it's important to have communication, know how mature you are. And there's no, like, being truthful with oneself. Like, maybe that's something I thought I wanted. I don't want it after I experience it. Or maybe I experience it. Oh, I want this.
Yeah.
I have to be mature enough to know how to go about that, it. You know?
Bro, you got a great mindset on you, and it's true. And communication and honesty is the main thing. And that's why even when I meet girls, I tell them from the very beginning, look, I'm not a man with one woman. I would never have one woman. This is the way I am. If you don't like it, it's completely fine. You can go date someone else. We'll move on. But if you do, that's how I am. So I agree with you. I think being honest, and I even think women respect that the most.
Yeah. Women respect honest men.
Yeah.
And that's just being truthful.
Truthful,
you know, it's not like...
Not telling them what honest. They want to hear.
Yeah, just be yourself. Be real. Yeah. And I do want to say something like... I think... You know, when you think of a safe place, most of the time it's a family.
100%. You know? Our mother.
So the only way to do that is to, like... If we're looking at the person who inspired Bob Marley, it was Haile Selassie, right? And Haile Selassie had crowned his wife Empress at the same time to show equality. So I think that right there is like, it was a long way, because that was the late 1800s, early 1900s. And I studied a bit about it, that there's moments where Empress gave Emperor a lot of good advice that was necessary, right?
Yeah.
But we look at the details in that story.
Yeah.
We learn a lot
I'm going to study it. Because I do believe women, like good women, bring a lot of value to a man's life, like intuition, nurturing, especially intuition, because how many times would our mothers or our sisters tell us about a certain person that might be in your life and you might be like, nah, they're cool. But they always end up being right, man. Women have great intuition. When they feel something, they kind of know it. So yeah, I don't believe in equality. I don't believe men and women are equal. I think we are different, but I think we both bring different values to the earth.
It's
like yin and yang.
It just fits like a puzzle.
I agree with you, man. And that's why I think like things have gone so pear-shaped now, because men are more like women. Women want to be like men, and it's like that's fucking up the whole dynamics of a real traditional relationship.
Yeah. So I seen, you know who Naya Bingi is?
No.
Naya Bingi's a warrior from Africa.
Okay.
Like Naya Bingi drums.
Okay, yeah,
like,
yeah.
Like reggae music.
Okay.
Right? The origins of it is a warrior woman.
Yeah, yeah.
Whose husband was the general, and he would lay out the strategy and she would play it out. Okay. Right? So I feel like that's where that feminine masculine energy comes in, that we could have different roles, but at the end of the day, a man will be a man and a woman will be a woman.
Yeah.
No matter
what. We're so different to each other, man. Like even here on this podcast, we're literally attracted to the opposite things to each other.
Right. Exactly. Yeah,
women like experience, we like inexperience. Yeah. That's the truth. That's why we don't wifey whores, right? We don't settle down with whores and sluts, because we don't like a woman who slept with everyone. But then women tend to never go for virgins.
Right.
Because they lack experience. They lack men who are taller than them. We tend to like women who are more petite and shorter than us. So that's, I agree with you. Women and men be men. And, you know, that's why one thing I don't like about California now. I feel like men are more like women and women are more like men, and then we complain about each other. And I think more than 50% of women over 30 now are not in relationships for the first time ever in history. So we're heading over a slippery slope.
Well, all I will say is that there's between a man and a woman, only one can really be the portal for life. You know, as a man, we can give that seed, but.
Yeah.
The woman is the portal for
Yeah,
that.
She creates, yeah. Shit. For sure. Latinas or Asian girls?
Women. women. I love women, period.
All right, so you're not gonna discriminate.
I don't discriminate.
All right, cool. Tupac or Biggie?
Oh, man.
Because I was gonna ask you after that, black girls or white girls, and then ask you the winners, but all girls are the same. Tupac or Biggie?
Tupac or Biggie? You know what? We're on the West Coast, and I've been watching a lot of Tupac videos recently. So, but you gotta give respect to both of them.
Yeah,
you know? But Tupac. I've been on a Tupac vibe recently.
Okay, nice. Sauna or cold plunge?
I love the heat, but something about that cold plunge. I like how my mind is.
It makes you feel after, right? The dopamine, the freshness on your body, something else. Yeah.
I feel the, what's it called? The, I don't think. I'm just there and I like that.
And it gets rid of a lot of spike proteins as well, so.
No, I didn't know that.
Yeah. Mangoes or papayas?
Mango.
Mango. Are there two genders or many?
There's women and there's men.
Okay, cool. Oysters, oyster mushrooms or lion's mane?
Oyster mushrooms, lion's mane?
Yeah.
Oyster mushrooms.
Oyster mushrooms.
Wait, No. I was thinking of trumpet mushrooms. Okay. Lion's mane.
Lion's mane, yeah. I love all three of the ones we mentioned. You know, the trumpets, I make them look taste a little bit like scallops. The oyster mushrooms, you can make them like chicken, kind of like fried. And the lion's mane, I don't know if you've ever done it, but have you ever made it into like a steak?
I tried one time, but it looked more to me like glazed, like orange chicken.
Okay.
That's how it came out
different. Yeah. Okay. So what I did is I get a cast iron skillet and then I'll get my avocado oil, let it get on higher heat. And then I'll put the lion's mane in there, just salt and onion powder. And you get another cast iron pan and you put it on top. So it's like, it really like, what's the word?
Press?
Yeah, you press it, but there's a word for it when you cook something like deep heat. But anyway, yeah, you cook it like that and then you flip it around. And I've done it for my friends. Put a bit of truffle on it, red bell peppers, zucchini. And yeah, a lot of my friends think it tastes like meat. So even my girls, the same. So yeah, definitely lion's mane. Well, I'll make it next time. Next time you're in town, I'll make it for us on the barbecue. Power or speed?
Power or speed?
Yeah.
Speed kills, man.
Speed kills. I agree with you. Is the earth flat or sphere?
What?
Is the earth flat or sphere?
Man, I ain't never seen it straight, so I'm going to go ahead. Every time I fly, I swear I see that curve. I'm going to go with sphere.
Sphere, okay. Yeah. I'm a flat earther, me myself. But I've got a video coming out on it shortly, and you already know the government lies to us about pretty much everything, right?
Oh, they lie about a lot, man. But you know, I don't go too deep into things.
I'll send you a documentary to watch because it's an interesting one. And take it from there, because I'd say I've never seen curvature. I've been in the plane a lot of times. I've been on the edge of cliffs where they say that you should be able to see curvature. But yeah, we won't go too deep into it, but I'll send you that documentary. Okay, would you rather no wild meat for a year or no girls for a year?
But you know what's the crazy part is that I'll do, like, I won't be with women before I fight. You know, won't be with
you don't want to get rid of that testosterone.
Nah, so.
But for a year, no girls for a year or no meat
no,
for a year?
No, but so check it. If I do no wild game, like no wild game for a year.
Yeah.
Then I'm not fighting anything over a certain weight.
Yeah.
If I'm not with women for a year, then you know I'm fighting all year and I'm eating as much as I can.
Yeah.
Oh, man. No wild gain.
No wild gain. Yeah. Okay, cool. Okay. So you'd pick the girls for a year. So the winner, no girls for a year or no jiu-jitsu for a year?
Oh, I've done it before. I can do, I mean, if we're focused on the mission in this life, yeah, what I'm here for, I can do 1 year without women.
Okay, so no, jiu-jitsu over everything.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, and the lot.
The woman will
always be there. Yeah. And last but not least, Trump or Biden?
Oh man, that's you know, no one can deny what's been happening, but I'm not political, so okay. You know, but it's good to be able to speak.
Yeah.
During an interview.
So you'd go with Trump then?
I'm not political.
Okay. He said he gave us a political answer though. But yeah, in other words, we don't want a fucking idiot in who can't even talk. So yeah.
You have to be able to
be competent.
Take care of yourself.
Yeah. Okay, Roberto, thank you very much for coming on the interview today. You gave the people lots of gems. Looking forward to the future. Definitely gonna have some streams in the future where we're gonna get some rolling involved. Try get when Tom Aspinall comes out here. Even Cheeto, I'm gonna try and make the Cheeto thing happen. I know you know Cheeto, but I have a close friend of mine who's actually close friends with Action Bronson as well, and I know him and Cheeto are like best buddies. So maybe next time he's out there as well, and we'll get a stream going, and we'll get it cracking, man.
That'd be dope. Yeah. Get some training.
Yeah, maybe like you. It'll be good to see him rolling with Tom Aspinall. You guys are similar weights, and maybe I'll get my ass beaten by Cheeto. Let's see.
Yeah, we'll have fun, man.
Yeah. All right. Thank you very much, people. Until next time, have a good one. Take care. Bye bye.